Okay, welcome anyone, everyone. My speech will not be in Japanese because I cannot speak Japanese, but I will try to speak slowly. So this is the title of my presentation, and I want to sort of simultaneously argue that learning analytics has much to offer, but that we also should reflect on what would be the particular challenges which we need to address. So the basic message which I want to articulate with my presentation is that we should link learning analytic research with looking into new educational designs and how those can be influenced by data-driven approaches. And one of the arguments where I see maybe to base some criticism for reflection is that a lot of learning analytic research measures certain things which are easy to measure, and then we value these things. But the real challenge is that we should value educational objectives and goals, and then we should develop measurements for what we value. So this is an overview of the four themes which I want to go through. First, articulate some guiding principles for new educational designs, talk a little bit what I call the age of dataism, and then exploit opportunities and pitfalls and finish with some conclusions. So we all, I don't know how many of you work in learning and education, and we all may pursue have different principles, different major objectives. And I have worked in this area for a long time, and over the years, these are where some of the particular objectives which we tried to articulate with our research. We weren't alone, other people pursued similar things. And I briefly want to mention these principles. So the first one is to say we want to create educational learning environments where people do not have to learn, but want to learn. So I live in Boulder, Colorado, and if you ask people, do you want to go skiing or do you have to go skiing, more people would answer, I want to go skiing. Whereas if you ask people, do you want to go to class or do you have to go to class, more people probably will say, we have to go to class. So we as learning theorists, as educators, as teachers, how can we kind of do this shift a little bit that people want to do that? And we studied success models for these where people want to do things, and I don't know how prominent Lego construction kits are in Japan, but Lego, many people want to play with Lego, they don't have to play with Lego. And some of you may have heard of the Scratch programming environment, which I think is another nice example where people around the world participate voluntarily. The second argument which I want to argue for is when we think about learning and the role of teacher and learners, we often associate this with a person. And I think by associating this not with a person, but with a context, we can explore additional interesting aspects. So if I come here to Kyoto or to Japan, I am obviously a learner compared to all of you. Whereas if you would come to Boulder, Colorado, I potentially would be the teacher and you would be the learners. And my graduate students and undergraduates, many of those are definitely my teacher if it comes to new developments in social media or if the latest trick in programming languages. I think a lot of our educational environments were designed that we learn when the answer is known. And the basic assumption was that the teacher knows the answer, knows the material, and the learners do not know the answer. And the major efforts were spent on that the learners know what the teachers know. We have been particularly interested in learning when the answer is not known, meaning we all get together, like maybe this symposium is an example for this, where none of us necessarily has the answer what learning analytics could be, should be, but we come together, bring different minds together, and we hope we learn from each other, but the answer is not really known in this case. The next point is schools and universities we often consider as given, God-given artifacts. And in the plan which Hiroaki just showed, they will eventually in later years go into schools. And the question is, do we take schools as givens or are schools social constructs? Schools are invented in societies for different purposes. And so the question is, as our times change, our world changes, should the schools also change? And the last point is that teaching and learning are not inherently linked. I think in today's world, there is a lot of learning without teaching. And me being a teacher, I try to remind myself often that there is teaching without learning. So let's say, in some ways, me being a presenter in this meeting today, if you don't learn anything, there is little purpose that I give a presentation. So I always took this challenge very seriously to say, well, how can I make sure that if I act as a teacher, that the students are learning something? So these are the issues where I have a little bit more information, but I think I explained them to some extent, so I would like to skip those and come up with one fundamental distinction for learning, which has, I think, particularly influenced the development of different approaches with new media towards learning. And the first aspect is, at least in the United States, goes back to Skinner and behaviorism, and this led to intelligent tutoring systems and to instructionist approaches. Instructionist approaches, I do not claim that they are in any way should not be pursued, but I would say they should be complemented with other approaches. And the second approach is sort of anchored in the United States in Dewey's inquiry-based learning, and it led to learning environments and to constructionist approaches. And if you want to look in more details into this, some of the, on the left side in the purple category, it led to systems like computer-assisted instruction system, intelligent tutoring systems. The role of the teacher is often characterized being the sage on the stage. How we structured the material was structured by curriculum. We wanted to teach young people basic skills and cultural literacy were some of the teaching objectives. And the recent development of MOOCs, I think, falls again clearly in this category. And if we wanted to test whether people did well in this, you had tests which tested people on the same metric. And my argument is learning analytics research to a very large extent has been grounded, perceived in these types of activities. Now on the right side, people perceive that the learner is the teacher of the computer, and by programming, the learner teaches the computer something, and thereby the learner learns more about his own thinking. The teacher acts often as the guide on the side, and if we want to characterize this type of learning, we can argue that it is much more driven by interests. It can be linked to discovery learning, and it pursues idiosyncratic niches, and if you are familiar with the concept of long tail, that plays a role here. People developed certain materials for these created learning environments, and what I mentioned earlier with Lego would fit into this category in Scratch. And people in this context often pursue projects, and so there is an individual metric to it. So the testing in comparison becomes much more difficult in the right-hand side. So now I try to characterize sort of my personal beliefs about educational objectives and also set a certain classifications differentiating different ways to approach this. And in this next part, I want to talk about what I call the age of dataism. And I think one slogan which people have created centered around big data said data is the oil of the 21st century. So we are all after data, many companies. And dataism, this is a definition from an author in the New York Times, is an obsession with data that assumes a number of things about data, including that it is the best overall measure of any given scenario, and that it always produces valuable results. And I want to basically illustrate this a little bit more in the next phase of my talk. Now we can ask, why has this emerged as a big topic now? Well, there are technological changes. We have all these gadgets which help us to generate data. And it's also easy to collect the data because a lot of interactions already happen inside of computational environments. So here is an overview over big data. I mentioned numerous additional topics where big data research is pursued, but one of it is learning analytics. And I think we can embed many of the ideas which we pursue about learning analytics in slightly more broader pictures centered around big data. It's a big topic. I think some evidence for it is every American university over the last 2-3 years announced positions, faculty position in big data. Or if you would go to one of the major MOOCs offering companies like Coursera or edX, data science courses about big data are at the top of their list. There are numerous offerings about this topic. So in the past, until some time ago, the physical and the digital world was disconnected. So there was the physical world, and it was disconnected from the digital world. Like, people bought books at bookstores, at physical bookstores. Now many people buy books at Amazon. And so because it's done inside a computational environment, this information can be tracked, traced, and Amazon comes up with statements like, people who bought this book, which I am buying now, also bought these other books. That was not possible when we went just out to a physical bookstore and bought a book there. So the digital world has grown dramatically, and what not already happens inside the digital world, there are sensor systems which map what's going outside into the physical, into the digital world. And learning analytics, if it's pursued, for example, in the context of MOOCs, all the interactions which a learner has with the computational, with a learning environment is tracked. And using credit cards instead of cash, our transactions get traced. And so this is sort of the technological environment which facilitates big data issues. So learning analytics, this is a fairly general accepted definition of what learning analytics is all about. So we want to collect the data, visualize it for the purpose of understanding and improving learning. That's a big hope. I tried with my introductory remarks to say, well, this still depends what kind of learning we want to improve. And I just argued that this is brought by the digital transformation. And we have wearable devising hardware sensors. And the objective is that we create something like evidence-based learning and education, which Hiroaki also mentioned in his remarks. And a big model for evidence-based scientific investigation is evidence-based medicine, where the same attribute being evidence-based played a big role. We may also ask, well, if we do learning analytics research, for whom is it? Who can profit from whatever we created? It may be governments, and I will say in a minute something about PISA. It may be school districts. It may be learning scientists, researcher gaining a better understanding what learning is all about, comparing different approaches, collecting data about the different approaches. It may be teachers, but it may be also very valuable for the learner itself. So I briefly want to mention PISA. Maybe some of you have heard about it. It's a big worldwide effort taking place every 3 years where students are assessed in science, mathematics, reading, collaborative problem solving, and financial literacy. And because we are here in Japan, you should all be very proud, because as you see, in all three categories, Japan appears in the first column on second place, in the next column on eighth place, and in the last column on fifth place. I come originally from Germany, but I live in the United States. Neither Germany nor the United States appear in this list. So congratulations to Japan and your apparent excellent educational system. So here is a little bit of discussion which was done to follow up on these PISA studies, and we may be able to discuss this among each other in the breaks or in the panel. So people congratulated Japan, as I just indicated, but then there were also maybe two concerns or two advice, pieces of advice. Namely, one was that while Japanese 15-year-olds do very well, in the tests, they are not aspirational of scientific careers as much as students in other countries. And maybe if we link this back to some of the arguments which I had at the beginning, they can be related to some of these aspects. And the second thing is, students do well in the test, but they do not see that, well, doing the test is a kind of secondary activity. The real activity is how do you get prepared for life, and how do you, with whatever you learn, open up opportunities for having a meaningful and productive life. And this would be, again, what can we as learning analytics researcher make sure that we also want to address the two bottom comments. How much time do I have left?
8 minutes.
8 minutes. I quit. So let me be articulate about what I consider some of the potential pitfalls. If we engage in learning analytics research, maybe we want to have some of these things in mind. So they can influence our behavior. I learned a little bit that the age index, you may know what that is or not, it's a measurement of the quality of the publications which academics produce. And it has become in the United States an incredibly important measurement. So it's data which is generated by Google Scholar, and it allows to assess the productivity as well as the reception of other researchers by a particular researcher. And young people, young faculty members, PhD students, postdocs, are oriented very strongly towards improving their age index. So many other things sort of disappear in the background, their natural curiosity, but it's an important question for them to ask, how can I improve my age index? The third point is that we try to create numbers, because numbers can be easily compared. So we have GPA, we have this age index, and I consider it as very questionable whether we can basically reduce a human life to a single number. And the last point which I want it to mention is ethics and privacy. I think our data is a payment often for free and cheap services which are available over the internet. And if you followed the news over the last 2-3 days, there is a worldwide outcry that Facebook was hacked by Cambridge Analytics, and the data of 50 million people was distributed illegally. So this is all real, this is big data, and I think as learning analytics researchers, where we also pursue to look into data, generate data, this is a very important point. Let me give you one more specific example. So personalization is one of the big hopes that we can achieve this with learning analytics. Just like Amazon personalizes our book buying habits on analyzing what we bought before. And it's a highly desirable strategy, but people have discussed the downside of this. And in America, a concept which has emerged is filter bubbles, or some people also call it echo chambers. And what it means, if we are always guided towards what we already know, we may kind of lose the sight for alternative opinion. And I think it's a very interesting and I would say serious problem. And again, I use an American example. There are TV stations, 24-hour news TV stations like CNN on one side and Fox News on the other side. They generate filter bubbles. And if you exclusively watch one of these stations, you probably believe that you live in two different worlds, not in the same world. So I already mentioned at the very beginning that one of the challenges is that we value, that we move from, that we value what we measure. As academics, we are often measured by the number of publications which we produce. But the real challenge may be the quality of a publication. But many of these things which we value are much more difficult to measure. They are not as to measure as simple as a uniform test given to everyone. So as we make progress and go ahead with data analytics, with learning analytics research, these are some of the questions which we may want to ask ourselves. Are we suffering from a data dictatorship? So what we do, what we decide, is it influenced by data? And is data sort of the single decision criteria for what we do? Or what place is, as we live in a data-dominated world, what place is there for intuition, creativity, uncertainty, and originality? And I think a problem which we also haven't really understood yet is how can we understand the secondary effects? So if we move towards this dataism world, what other effects will it cause? And here is an example. Maybe it will cause that we will think about putting different information on people's tombstones. So you could reflect what, you know, what kind of information you would like to put on your tombstone. So is this how we eventually define ourselves? So let me conclude, which I like to conclude some of my presentation with. And I think the challenge is that the future is not out there to be discovered, like Columbus discovered America. But I think we as researchers in learning science, in learning technologies, in learning analytics, we in part invent and design this future, just like Facebook does it at a much larger scale and has definitely invented a certain way of human behavior. And so the question which we can ask, I mean, who invents this future? Is it just the people in Silicon Valley? Is it the MOOCs company? Is it the Secretary of Education of the United States, who is totally at odds with most learning scientists? I don't know to which community you belong. Some of us belong to technology-enhanced learning, computer-supported collaborative learning, computer-supported cooperative work. Are these communities do have any influence? Or is the future really invented and designed by all of us? And what kind of contribution can we make? And as you have a very large-scale project about the future of learning analytics in Japan, maybe, you know, you can really make a difference. And so to return basically to the beginning of my talk, I mean, there is a certain hype currently associated with learning analytics, but there is also, on the opposite side, maybe an underestimation. We haven't really explored all the possibilities which we have. We do not yet understand all the challenges. And so I would say the challenge in this area is to create a principled based on educational principle, learning theories, and so on, a principled and balanced data ecosystem so that we can contribute to transform, enhance, and support learning for the 21st century, which I think is an articulated objective of learning analytics research. Thank you.